Well, good morning, church. Come on, when you stand to your feet. Our God is worthy of our praise. He's worthy of our song. He's a good God. Come on. We love you, Jesus.
Of God, that's still inside the storm, the promise of the shore. I trust the power of your word, enough to seek your kingdom first. Beyond the barren place, beyond the ocean waves, I walk through the waters, I won't be overcome. When I go through the rivers, I will not be drowned. My God will make a way, so I'm not afraid. You keep the promises you made.
With you. We love singing about what our God has done, promises he's made to us in his word. But before we go on, I just want to stop, and I feel like we need to just refocus again together on the truth that the bridge of that last song kind of got at it, where it said that he's before us, he's behind us, that we're never alone. And I'm reminded that he is for us, not against us. He's not against you this morning. He's for you. So would you right now, all over this place, just close your eyes. And if you need to know that again today in a fresh way, that God is for you, would you just put your hands out in front of you? If that's you, if you need to be reminded of that again today. God, you see every heart. Jesus, I pray that there would come a fresh confidence in every single heart here today. that you are for them, not against them. That you love them with unfailing love. In Jesus' name.
It was my cross you bore so I could live in the freedom you died for. And now my life is yours, and I will sing of your goodness forevermore. Worthy is your
cast my mind to Calvary, where Jesus bled and died for me. I see his wounds, his hands, his feet, my Savior on that cursed tree. His body bound and drenched in tears, they laid him down in Joseph's tomb. The entrance sealed by heavy stone, Messiah still and all alone. Come on, oh praise. Oh, praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise his name forevermore. For endless days we will sing your praise. Oh, Lord our God. Bless your name. Then on the third, at break of dawn, the Son of Heaven rose again. Oh, trampled death, where is your sting? The angels roar for Christ the King. Transfixed on Jesus' face. Hallelujah. We give you the praise, Jesus, the only name by which we're saved. Church, would you just right now, get his praise on your mouth. Tell him yourself in your own words what he means to you, how thankful we are for him. He purchased salvation for us. He made us sons and daughters. Jesus, we're a thankful people. We acknowledge today, Jesus, in your presence, that it is by grace we've been saved, not of our own works. None of us can boast, not in ourselves. We boast in the cross of Christ, in the blood of Jesus that's made us righteous, that's made us free, that's healed us and saved us. We say thank you, God. We lift you up. We honor your name, Jesus, here today. And everyone said, amen.
All right, as you're being seated, turn to your neighbor and say, man, you sounded good today. It's great to see you guys. So good to have you out. Listen, I have the joy of bringing you an update regarding our grander vision, which you've been around here for a while. We're going to keep reminding you that by 2030, we see ourselves planting 3,000 churches worldwide. So we can say for every chair in this place, every chair a church. 3,000 churches worldwide through our partnership with Surge, 20 churches regionally. And if you were here last year, October, November, December, you know, we talked about our 2020 goal was we're going to flip the rest of that $2.4 million debt that we had to pay off. We were going to flip it this year, excuse me. 2020, we were going to eliminate that debt, and we were going to take the bulk of that payment and move it into corporate church planting to the tune of $500,000 a year. How many of you remember that, okay? And so we did a series called Kingdom Surge, where you had the opportunity to fill out a card like this. Now, again, to remind you, our number one commitment every year is to give our best to the ministry so that the ministry stays strong. What we ask as a commitment on this card was, what could you do over and above your regular giving to help us knock out the debt in 2020. If some of you haven't filled out this card yet, we have plenty of these cards left. We're going to believe where there's going to be new people coming on board with us throughout the year who say, hey, I want to help with that as well. And then beyond that, if you had over and above, you could help plant churches through our Surge project. Well, I want to just give you an update. As we did the as we came off the Surge, the Kingdom Surge project, we had $1.8 million in pledges, which we're hoping we'll see all of that fulfilled this year. And then we were going to move ahead $400,000 in 2019 surplus giving. We actually did end with over $400,000, not only in what came in over and above, but what we underspent. We want to move all of that ahead, which leaves about $200,000, which I believe is going to be new pledges throughout the year or year-end giving at the end of this year. We're going to knock out that 2.4. I want to just bring you an update that this past week, just 6 weeks into the new year, we just sent $600,000. That's one quarter of the 2.4. We've already knocked that out. Is that awesome? So praise God and thank you for your giving. Now, in addition to that, I just heard that though we ended the year somewhere around 430 churches planted with Surge, I just got the most recent update that while all of this is going on, we've planted another 20 churches. We have 450 churches that have been planted. And of course, you know, we're going to be starting our first regional church in October, which you're going to hear more about as well. Now, all of that to say, mark your calendars. Get your calendars out now. We've got a couple things I want you to know about, but all related to the Kingdom Surge. 2 weeks from now, we're going to have Dr. Henrik Voorster with us. And since he was stopping by for a couple of days, I thought, you know what? I'm going to give him the weekend service because I want you to hear this guy. He has literally had a hand in planting hundreds of thousands of churches. He has now come on board with Surge. He is out training all of our church planters, so they get great training before they go to plant a church. And I asked Dr. Voorster, who knows like no one else, the difference between a great church and a not-so-great church, and I want you to come and challenge Northwoods to be the greatest church we can be for the kingdom of God. So put it on the calendar and be here 2 weeks from now to hear Dr. Voorster. He's an amazing, amazing man. All right, now, ushers, if you'll come forward right now, I say all of that related to Kingdom Surge to say thank you for your faithful giving. Let's just keep on giving our best to the Lord because he's using it to make an amazing difference. Now, while they're taking the offering, again, keep your calendars out, a couple of things that are coming up. 2 weeks from now, February 28 and 29, we're in a leap year, right? We have a centered conference coming. This is for parents, grandparents, or those who are helping children in any way. We're gonna have a conference with a lot of different workshops, how to pray with your child, how to help them navigate social media, how to have spiritual conversations with them. It's gonna be a great conference for you to invest in yourself as one who is helping lead your children. It's gonna be a Friday night and Saturday. So we're gonna serve you dinner on Friday night. We're gonna serve you breakfast on Saturday morning. We are gonna make sure that your kids are covered birth through sixth grade. Come on, what's not to like about that? And we're only gonna charge $5 for the whole deal. And so I say, if you, listen, put it on your calendar and be here. You can go to northwoods.church/centered to sign up for the Centered Conference, okay? Hope you'll make use of that as well. Then, a couple of weekends from now, the first two full weekends in March, we're gonna stop for a little bit and we're gonna celebrate like we've never celebrated before, because guys, we're gonna be celebrating our 30th anniversary as a church. Is that amazing? Holy cow, I was only 15 when I came here. 15, I'm 45 today. Been here 30 years. You know, we're gonna be looking back at some of those pictures of what some of us looked like when we were 15. We're gonna be, listen, that first weekend, we're gonna be singing some of the songs we sang way back then. We're gonna just kind of turn the clock back, and we're calling it Faithful. We're gonna celebrate for 2 weeks the faithfulness of God and his hand on this church through these 30 years. But we're gonna do a whole lot more as well. So I want you to mark your calendar for Friday night, March 6th. We're gonna have a worship pull out the stops, and we're going to worship, a concert of worship here, followed by a dessert social. Yeah, does that sound good? So that's on March 6th. Then the 7th and 8th, again, that'll be our first weekend of celebrating our 30th, March 12th. You want to put that on the calendar. That's a Thursday night. We're gonna have the Collingsworth family here. And if you don't know the Collingsworth family, trust me, you wanna be here, you'll thank me later. I know you may not like my Southern gospel music, but this is something a little different. You may not like my quartet. This is a family that is absolutely, they're amazing musicians, and they have been like Grammy nominated, Dove Award winners, this type of thing. We've got the phones ringing off the wall about how I can get a ticket for the Collingsworth family. I want you to have first dibs on that, all right? So go to northwoods.church/Collingsworth. It's $10 a person or $25 for your family. Trust me, that's a steal for wherever they go. They're in demand all over the place, and you're not gonna wanna miss the Collingsworth family. Then that week, that's the 12th, 14th, put a slash through that because we're not gonna have a Saturday night service. We wanna get you in here and fill this place up two times over on the 15th as we pull out all the stops for an amazing 30th anniversary. You're gonna wanna be here. We're right now working on a little gift that we wanna give you, but you gotta be here to get it. So that means even you online family, if you're close by, listen, we're not sending it in the mail. You're gonna have to be here, all right? We're gonna fill up this place two times over. We're gonna just have a fantastic time of thanking God for what he's done for the first 30 and looking ahead to how his faithfulness is gonna take us into our next 30. Amen? Are you ready for that? All right. Guys, while the screens are coming down at our other campuses, I want you to give a warm welcome to Galesburg, to Chile, to Canton today, and our online family. Would you tell them, great to have you guys with us. And I am delighted to share with you this guest speaker today named Rodney Wright. Rodney was for years an executive pastor at a church in Coeur d'Alene, Idaho, and then recently left that position to raise funds for himself so that he could raise funds for a ministry called Pure Desire. I met Rodney because I'm on the board of Pure Desire. He's been on the board of Pure Desire, and it's an incredible ministry that is helping churches have conversations around sexual health and helping people who are just broken in their, you know, sexual woundedness come into a place of healing and wholeness in the church. And I believe, along with Rodney, that the church ought ought to be the leading voice when it comes to that today in our culture. Amen? And so Rodney and the team from Pure Desire have been here for several days. We've ridden them hard, man. They came and spoke to our youth on Wednesday night, to parents on Wednesday night, spoke with the staff on Thursday, did a Valentine's banquet on Friday, met with our men's and women's groups on Saturday, met with our small groups all through Saturday. Rodney preached yesterday, first service day. I'm tired. Just telling you what he's done, but I want you to give him a warm welcome as he comes to share with us today.
You,
Rodney Cal. Wright, Pure Desire. God bless you guys.
Thanks, Cal. Thank you, buddy. Thank you, brother. Thank you so much. Well, hello, everyone. How many of you know Cal gets heavy when he's right, when he's on top of you? You know what I mean? He's heavy to carry, that Cal. So I'm glad to be here. But listen, it has been a delight in all the formats and meetings that our whole team has been at. And I'll speak for Justin and Trevor and Ashley and Heather, thank you, and my wife, whose name is Tracy. Yeah, Tracy. So yeah, thank you. Let's try to get everybody's name. It's been a long week, but we're honored to be here. On behalf of our founders, Dr. Ted and Diane Roberts, thank you so much for letting us share your stage and just communicate. On behalf of our executive director, Nick Stumbo, him and his wife, Michelle, have been here before. It's an honor to be here today. Last week, there was a great message on Unhappily Ever After that John, Pastor John, spoke on. If you haven't listened to that message, I would encourage you to do that. I listened to it this week. It's a really great message about the priorities and about pursuing each other in marriage and really about the partner of oneness. And it was really a fantastic talk that he gave, and so I would encourage you to do that. We want to continue kind of on this subject here today. About intimacy. And I think whether you're single or married, this message, I believe, will be very beneficial to you today. And so if you have your iPhone or your device, you can pull up YouVersion or probably go to the website, and there's a way that you can electronically see the notes there. They'll be on the screen as well. And so just make sure you're not on Facebook during any time of my message here today. Okay, but if you have to, I mean, you get it. I get it, you know. Just people will be watching you, so. The thought that I was given to talk about is what sabotages our intimacy. What sabotages our intimacy? I would start with this premise today, that we are made for intimacy. This is how we're all wired, is for intimacy. And I want to start looking at the biblical text today. So if you have your Bible, you can turn to this passage, Genesis 1:1. So we're going to start in the very first verse of the Bible. Now, I'm not going to have time to get through the whole Bible this morning. Cal's going to pick some of this up next week. But this is where I want to start here today as we look about, we're all made for intimacy. Genesis 1:1. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. The scriptures that we have, the 66 books, they were written in Hebrew and Aramaic and Greek, a number of different authors over hundreds and hundreds of years, all testifying to who God is, revealed clearly in Jesus, the Word made flesh, the living Word of God that endures forever, Jesus. But the word here in the Hebrew language for God is the word Elohim. Can you say that with me, Elohim?
Elohim.
Elohim. It's a Hebrew word. And Elohim in this translation, or in this verse, is translated in the singular tense. But it can also be translated in the plural sense. Not just God, but plural, gods. Interesting. If you get down to verse 26 of that same chapter, the scripture continues, and then God, Elohim, speaks. And this is what Elohim says. Let us, there's that plural language, make mankind in our image and in our likeness. So God created mankind in his image and his likeness. This God is one, yet this God is plural. This God is many. What is this? Well, we believe that the context of Scripture testify, even though the word Trinity isn't found in the text, we believe that God is in relationship, God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. This is an interesting doctrine that we believe within Christendom. In fact, it's one of the only doctrines, or one of the few doctrines where Catholic, Protestants, and Orthodox all agree on one doctrine. How many know that's a miracle in itself right there? That we would all agree on one doctrine. And here's the doctrine, that what's most true about God is God is one being, but in this beautiful relationship, God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. And what we believe in historical Christianity is that there's no hierarchy in God. They're mutually submitted one to another. It's a beautiful concept. I used to think that the Father was the big kahuna and he had two sidekicks, Tonto and Festus, the Son and the Spirit, you know? No. One being, all in beautiful relationships, submitted one to another. In fact, they're mutually indwelling without losing their distinctiveness. Not three gods, but one being that's in this beautiful relationship, mutually indwelling. It's the same imagery that Pastor John talked about last week when he says, in marriage, a man will leave his father and mother and cleave to his wife, and the two shall become what? One. It's the same imagery. In marriage, there's a oneness that can happen. We're physically, mutually indwelling through our sexuality and through our hearts that we bind together, yet we don't lose our distinctiveness as husband and wife. It's the imagery that we get here in the scripture. And this is why Jesus, when he came to earth, first of all, the shepherd said, you will call his name Emmanuel, for God is with us. God came. God came in Jesus. And Jesus claimed, his claim sounded like this. If you've seen me, you've seen the Father. The Father and I, he said, are one. And in the Jewish mind, in the Shema, they knew that. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one. And now you claim to be one with God? How can this be? Mind-boggling for those first century Palestinians and Jewish people and Romans who heard the testimony of Jesus. You are one with God, mutually indwelling, without losing their distinctiveness. God in flesh, the scripture says. Interesting. The Apostle Paul writes in Colossians 1 that Christ is the visible image of the invisible God, and the fullness of the Godhead dwells in him. So I would propose today that what's most true about God is relationship, and that you and I are made in the image of this relational God. And we're made for intimacy. And intimacy, here's a great definition of intimacy I want to give you. Intimacy is simply, into me you see. Intimacy. It's about knowing and being known. And I would propose today that you can be very intimate with someone and not be sexual. And this is what's confusing so much for our children in the young culture. We live in a culture that sexualizes everything. And this is the confusion that our kids are growing up in, because some of us can be very sexual but know nothing about intimacy. And some of us can be very intimate because we share our thoughts and our feelings and we're known. People know our story because we're all made for intimate relationships. It's our greatest human need and we all have it. We're designed and made to participate in sexuality, but our greatest need is intimacy, intimate relationships. And then if you read on in the text, it says, in the image of God, he created them, male and female, he created them. Both male and female are made in the image of God. In fact, I would say it this way. If you want to know what God may look like, everybody in this room, just find a woman sitting around you and look at her. She is made in the image of God. Can I get an amen from any lady in the house here today? Yeah, thank you. For the screamer on the second row, God bless you. Because maleness and femaleness are both made in the image of God. And I think one of the things that I love the most about the teachings of Jesus when he came to earth is he was taking those who had a lesser value, females, and he was raising their worth and value as humans, made in the image of God. In fact, some theologians believe it went like this. When the Trinity was creating Adam, they created him out of the dust and they stood back and they simply said, hey, I think we can do better than this. Yeah. Oh, a smattering of applause over here. Okay. Right? Some theologians believe it went like this. Had the Trinity created Eve first, they probably would have said, you know, I don't think we can top this. Let's just stop right here. Let's just stop creating right here. This is it, right? No, that's not true. But is there any woman power in the room here today, ladies? I mean, you know, ladies, if not, you should ask me to come back for Mother's Day, for sure. I should be your Mother's Day speaker here. What I'm saying is that our humanity, maleness and femaleness, both derive in the image of God, and what God made is good, very good. And then in the text, we read that God blesses them. It says, God bless them, which is a fascinating word. If I were to sneeze, you would say, God bless you. In the Hebrew language, the word for blessed is the word barach. Barach. Say that with me, would you? Barach. Yeah, it sounds like the word barach. And I know that's challenging for some of our conservative Republicans in the house here today. Stretches us, but it's good for us. The word barach in the Hebrew has a root that says to kneel and adore. Get your mind around that. That God, Father, Son, and Spirit, they create what they love and they love what they create. They adore you. They adore you. And I would propose they've always have. It also has a meaning to empower or to consecrate. And then God says to Adam and Eve, be fruitful and multiply. So not only does God affirm their humanity and their sexual beings, male and female, and let me just stop and say, we need to reclaim the sanctity and the beauty of how God made us both in our image. And when we have a little baby boy, affirm their boyness. Amen? Yeah. And we have a little girl. This is how God made you in their image, a beautiful little girl. There's so much confusion in our world in this arena. And then God says, be fruitful and multiply. And that's God affirming our sexuality. That's God saying, somebody light a candle and turn on Kenny G. That's really what the translation is in the Hebrew language, right? And it's interesting that God affirms our sexuality. I believe that the church needs to do a better job talking about healthy sexuality, that we see it as good and made in the image of God. Did you know that a baby girl at birth, a little baby girl can vaginally lubricate in the first 24 hours of birth? And a little boy, the first 5 minutes of birth, can have an erection. Now, some of you think, well, that explains a lot, actually, right there. But the reality is, it's not because they're perverted. It's because that's how God made their bodies. And their humanity and their sexuality, male and femaleness, isn't evil. It's actually good. And it's made in the image of God. And God says, this beautiful gift of sexuality, it works best. It's designed by the Creator to work in a committed relationship, a covenant of marriage between a husband and wife, where there's a foundation that we're given to share this gift with one another. And God created us for creation, for pleasure. I like to call it strategic nerve endings, and for bonding and for procreation. That God creates and then invites us to participate in creating. And how many of you know when you've been there in the hospital, when your wife gives birth, how many know it's just like a sacred moment? My sister is a labor and delivery nurse in California, and she gets to participate in the sacred every day. But when my little daughter Whitney was born, unbelievable. My first little girl, my wife Tracy and I held this little girl. And I didn't kneel and adore her, but boy, did I lay my checkbook right on her chest. And I said, honey, I'm all in. It's all yours. That girl's been writing checks ever since. I'm telling you, she's been writing checks. But we got her married a couple summers ago, and now her and her husband have their own checkbook. But where is it in the heart of this dad to love a girl like that, to love a child so deeply that I would adore, that I would literally give my life for them? Where does that love come from, you think? I think it goes right back to our Creator, Father, Son, and Spirit. Why? Because you and I are made in the image of God. And I believe this is what's true about every human in this room and in the world, that what's most true about us is that we're the image bearers of the divine, and we're good, and we have great worth and great value. Intimacy. We're all made for that intimacy, to know and be known, and I think it's so important. But as we see in the Genesis narrative, that my second thought is that fear and shame distort our view. And when Adam and Eve were deceived and they trusted not God, but went a different route, and sin enters the equation, as the scripture tells us in Romans, that one man's sin, that we've all been affected by this disease of sin. And one of the effects of sin on Adam and Eve is that when they heard God in the garden, chapter 3, verse 10, says, I heard you in the garden and I was afraid because I was naked, so I hid. That one of the effects of sin is that it creates fear and it creates shame. And the very one that they should feel the most safe with, God, they hid from. The effects of sin, that's what they bring. They bring fear and shame in our lives. And some of us in this room maybe know that more than others, just because of our own journeys in life. We have dealt with shame before. I know my journey of struggling in my sexuality in my adolescent years created so much shame in my world. If I could tell you just a little bit about my story and our time together, I'm the youngest of five children in the home I was raised. I was born in Salinas, California, on the Monterey Bay Peninsula. And when I was five, we moved to a town of Modesto in the San Joaquin Valley. My father today is 91 years old, soon to be 92, and my mom's 90. And if they were here, they're some of my best friends. In fact, I think they're amazing people, and I have such a great love for them. My father was an Assembly of God minister, and in the 70s, pastored a church of about 1,000 people. So, Cal, that was kind of the mega church before those days. And I remember growing up in church as a kid, and in those days, we went to church like 5-6 days a week. In fact, this last 5 days has reminded me of my upbringing, Cal. As a boy, I used to say, church, church, church. That's all we ever do is go to church. Because I wanted to go play baseball or do something a little bit different than church. Well, if I could describe my father to you, my father, Joe Wright, he's a cross between Billy Graham, Ronald Reagan, and 10% John Wayne. That's my dad. You got a visual on that guy? Yeah, a little more scattering of applause here. I like it. He's a super guy. But I thought growing up as a kid, it seemed like everything that guy did and touched turned to gold. I didn't think he ever made mistakes. In fact, when I was 16, I said to my mom, I asked my mom this question, has my dad ever sinned? Can you imagine asking that question? You know what my mom said? Oh, hun, I assure you, your father has sinned. Maybe not in the same ways I have. But the scriptures I read in Romans says that all have sinned, that we've all been affected by this disease of sin, and we've all been misguided in one way or the other. In fact, I think that we're all addicted to our way of thinking, and that sin really distorts our view of ourselves, our view of others, and sometimes it can even distort our view of God. As a young boy growing up, I didn't feel safe in our home or in our faith community to talk much about my sexuality. So when I was first exposed to pornography as a young boy, and it was like an explosion in my brain, and with my learning disabilities growing up in school and being a poor reader, and with my attention deficit disorder, this became something that just automatically captured my brain. And I wish I would have felt safe enough to go to the people that love me, my mom and dad, and to say, hey, Dad, I looked at pornography, this magazine, and it really had this effect on me, and can you help me with this? But I didn't feel safe to do that. But at the end of those services, I would come and pray, and I would say, God, please forgive me. I don't want to do this. Can you help me with this? And I would ask God to forgive me, and I would, what I thought was trying to tip the repentometer, you know? So I would repent enough where God would show me some grace and forgiveness. What I don't see as much as repentance anymore, but I was a young boy with a lot of regret and sorrow for my behavior that was mismanaging my sexuality. And this process happened in my life, and I would get up from the altar and say to God, I'll never do that again, I promise. I'll never do it again if you'll just forgive me. And I would feel purged, I would cry, I would read my scriptures, I would fast. And in my 20s, I started confessing to my brother Ryan, who was my best friend and How many know it's so good to confess? Confession is so good. The scripture says, confess your faults one to another. And so I was doing that. So I had confession and I had accountability and I had prayer, and yet I still wasn't transforming. And so I remember thinking in Bible school and in dating my wife, Tracy, well, I know what I'll do. I'll get engaged and get married, because how many know marriage fixes every problem that you have? Oh, yeah. Oh, no, it doesn't. No clap on that one, please. In fact, to our single friends here, marriage doesn't change us. It just reveals more of what it finds in us. If marriage finds you healthy, it's going to reveal your health. So the greatest gift you can bring to marriage is you just focusing on being a healthy person in all areas of your life, your money, your finances, your physical health, all those areas. It's just about your health. It's the best gift you bring to marriage. But I got married and I was honest with my wife about certain acts or certain things in my negative sexual history, but not about pornography, because in the theology that I grew up in, Christians couldn't have addictions. That's what I was believed. So I never had an addiction. I just had a problem last month that God forgave me of, and now I was doing okay until the next Friday or the next month came around. And what we know through pure desire, I had a binge purge cycle happening in my world. I was a guy that loved God. I was accountable. Ultimately, I became accountable to my Father. So I had prayer. I had scripture. I had accountability. How many know that you can have accountability and still not have integrity? That's called the mafia. The mafia have high accountability. They just don't necessarily have a lot of integrity. Integrity is when we integrate the way of God in all areas of our life. And I didn't know how to integrate the way of God in my sexuality. And as a young boy growing up in my adolescence, I thought that all my sexual feelings were lust and evil. And that's not true. And some of our sexual feelings and arousal is involuntary. And even though we can't always handle that, what we can always handle is how to manage our sexual behavior. And this is why we believe at Pure Desire, we need to begin to educate young parents about how to talk to their kids about healthy sexuality. And if you're like me and my parents, many of us just never got training. We never got training, right? And I love that Pure Desire has resources. And one of them is called Digital Natives. Digital Natives. It's about raising our kids in an online culture. And this is a fabulous resource, parents, that you can get and begin to read about how to help your kids. And my wife and I, Tracy, just wrote a book called How to Talk with Your Kids About Sex. And I recommend this even if you're not married, but you're planning on it, or even if you're a single parent, or even if you're a grandparent that's helping. This is really about the culture of communication and the family system where it's safe to talk about anything in your home, because mom and dad are educated, mom and dad understand, and home is the place where we should learn about our sexuality. How many believe that we as the church need to equip our families so that culture doesn't have to be the educator for our kids about sexuality, right? That, there you go, everyone should clap on that. That we're not letting the school systems or somebody else, the culture, or we're not letting pornography be the sex educator for our kids. That we as mom and dad should reclaim the subject, that our humanity is good, that our sexuality is good. But if you don't know what you don't know, you don't know what to give them. And I remember the shame that my sexual sin had on me. I remember taking my two boys camping one time at Farragut State Park, and we were cooking chili, and which means we opened a can and put it in the thing, camping the tent. And even though I had sobriety, because I'll come back to a part of my story where my healing journey started. I found sobriety at this point in my life, and I was managing my sexuality in a good way. And just in a long story, I was directed to a sexual trauma assessment treatment therapist in my 20s because I was praying and confessing, and that therapist became the journey of helping me understand that pornography isn't just a moral issue, it's a brain issue, that it affects your brain like a drug. And you can get in a limbic loop in the limbic part of your brain, that fight or flight. It's been a long week, Cal. That's all, folks. Fight or flight part of the brain, or freeze. And that neurological loop can happen. And then it can actually be a brain issue more than just a moral issue. It has moral implications. But if you have a physiological problem, sometimes you need physiological answers to learn how to retrain the brain. And so that therapist became my whole journey in my 20s of getting help and getting healing. And even though I had sobriety, what I didn't have is healing from my shame. I'm camping with my boys, and we're having this chili, and one of them just says to me, it's a great conversation, "Hey, Dad, have you ever looked at pornography?" You ever had one of those questions, the Southwest Airlines, wish you were somewhere else? Right? And you know what this great spiritual teacher full of wisdom said to their kids? Who wants more chili? I completely changed the subject. So skillfully, my kids didn't even know it. And you know why I did that? S-H-A-M-E. Shame. Brené Brown, who is a shame researcher, says this. When you deny your story, it traps you. But if you own it, you have a chance to write a brave new ending. And in my religious culture, even though I found help, it wasn't safe to own and to talk about your story. Long story short, 7 years ago, we came across Pure Desire in our community of faith in Coeur d'Alene, Idaho. The church there was about 1,500 adults on a weekend service. We planted the church about 18 years ago, and God did some amazing things. And we were as honest as we could, but there was still a lot of shame in this subject matter. And a friend from AA came to faith in Christ, and he said, "Hey, Rod, will you come with me to hear Dr. Ted Roberts talk about this Pure Desire ministry?" And I felt that same prompting of the Spirit. "Rod, do you want to participate in what we're doing to heal the church, to heal the world?" And I went, and Dr. Roberts talked about the neuroscience of the brain, which I had gone through Dr. Patrick Carnes' material in my healing journey. And then he talked about most of our addictive behaviors are because of trauma, many of them in our childhood years, that we don't know how to grieve and process. So we look for a coping mechanism to deal with the pain that's emotionally inside of us. And I'm grateful because I know Cal and your church really believes in speaking to some of the lies that come from those traumatic experiences. And we've been doing grief work, and so they dealt with the brain, they dealt with the traumas and grief and helping people grieve. And let me just say this. If you've been betrayed by a spouse or navigated divorce or had any kind of abuse or trauma in your life, your grief is not what's wrong with you. It's what's right with you. It's the appropriate emotional response to the loss that you've come. And sometimes in our faith communities, we just need to provide a safe place where people can acknowledge and grieve that painful experience that's happened to them. And then they talked about ways of retraining the brain, scripture and prayer and accountability. And those aren't bad, but it was all seen as spiritual. And it was the integration of the science study overlaid with the biblical truth and faith. It's not either or, folks. It's both and. God made our minds. God made our hearts. God made our bodies. And when we bring those together, they can bring healing and wholeness. So it was beautiful. In our congregation, in a five-year period, we saw over 200 men and women get out of the pew and get involved in a community group that was confidential for men or women, because one of the growing stats is that women struggle now with pornography and a sexual addiction. So we had groups for both men and women, and I led the way as a clergy sharing my story. And then we had groups for men and women who had been betrayed by their partner. And these are so important. And I just want to say to the woman or man here who's been betrayed, love yourself enough, please, would you, to seek help and get groups for you. Because even though it may be your spouse's issue, it affects us and it feels so personal. And we need a safe place where we can talk about and process that. And if we don't, we continue to live in fear and shame. And the fear is, if you knew me, if I really got intimate, into me you see, if you knew that I didn't have it all together, would you still love me? And that's the fear of rejection. And then along comes Jesus on the scene. And Jesus is taking the sexually broken people in his world, and he is healing their souls. And he's bringing worth and value to both male and female, both Jew and Gentile. He said it's good news for the whole world. Aren't you glad for that? Any Gentiles in the house here today besides me? Yeah, right? It's good news for all of us that what Christ did, that we've been included in the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus. And when you think about God, the Trinity, other-centered, self-giving love, I believe it's the love of God that leads us home. My last thought. It's the love of God, the scripture says, that even leads us to repentance. In fact, in 1 John, one of the early followers of Jesus said it this way, "Beloved, let us love one another." Relationship. "For love is of God. And everyone that loves is born of God and knows God. And if you don't love, you don't even know God. For God is" what? Love. It's the essence of God's character. And I believe to love is to have someone's best interest. And I didn't believe as a young boy that God had my best interest. I thought I was messing up too much and I didn't see God is safe. And I had a you love me, you love me not. And I didn't know how to navigate through that. And I was really grateful that God brought people and resources to help me. As my wife and I find healing in our journey and helped bring healing in other people's lives, and as our family grew, I wanted to express to my kids and not pass on that shame that I had had in my life for so long. I wanted my kids to know that they were loved and that that love is the power that transforms us. In the 90s and late 80s and 90s, there was a concept that came out within evangelical churches called the purity ring or promise ring. How many remember hearing about that? Where young people would come down up front and they would have a pledge of purity and they would make a vow in front of their church and their parents that they would not have sex before marriage. And the heart behind this, I think, was so good because it was trying to pass on some values to our kids. I'm just not sure that the way we went about it was the most helpful. Statistics that they said that a lot of kids, when they struggled in their sexuality, they felt a ton of shame. And so having to tell mom and dad, "Hey, I struggled," and some parents would take the ring off, or they would say, "When you marry, you can't wear that white dress." Or there was a lot of shame connected to people who mismanaged this part of their life and who struggled in this part of their life. Although the heart behind it was good. I said to my daughter, Whitney, when she turned 16, our oldest, "Hun, I want to take you out on a date. I want to give you a ring." So we went out on a date. She got a manicure. We went to some ring stores, and I went into a store, and we put a ring on her finger, just all these diamonds. It was a big, beautiful ring. And the guy said to me, "Mr. Wright, that ring cost $10,000. I said to my daughter, "I love it. Too bad it doesn't match your eyes, but I love it. Oh, it was so close. Let's keep looking." And we found a ring that fit my budget. It was in the hundreds, not the thousands. And I bought her this special ring. And I took her out and I said to Whitney, "Whitney, I want to give you this ring. Me to you. From the heart of your dad and your mom to you." And I said, "This ring is not a promise ring that you have to make to us. Because, hun, I believe that you want to make good choices in your sexuality. And I believe that you really care about that. But this isn't about a promise that you have to make to us, because I don't want you to mismanage your sexuality, but I don't want you to be a cheater either. And I don't want you to lie, and I don't want you to steal, and I don't want you to gossip. And honey, you don't have enough fingers, and I don't have enough rings for you to make all the external promises that you'll somehow reach a moral goodness. So this is not a promise ring. This is what I call a value ring. And this is not a promise that you're making to us. This is a promise we're making to you." And I put that ring on her finger. And I looked in that beautiful girl's eyes. And I said, "Hun, this is a promise that your worth and value will never change regardless of your behavior in our heart, in our eyes. That we will always love you. And we believe, hun, that you want to make good decisions in this area of your life. But even if you struggle in this area or any area, our heart will never turn from you. And I will never disown you. And you will always be my daughter. And I always have your best interest. And you can always trust me. So when you come to making decisions in your life that are difficult, I want you to look at this ring and say, 'Oh, yeah, I'm valuable.' And I want you to make decisions based on your internal worth, not just some external promise." How many know when you see your worth and value, it's easier to make better decisions in life? And it was a beautiful, sacred moment. It reminds me of the story that Jesus told in Luke 15. He was getting criticized because he was hanging around broken people. That Jesus, always hanging around the wrong group. Because everybody mattered to Jesus. So a lot of broken people in our society, a lot of broken people that sexuality has caused a lot of damage in a lot of different ways, in a lot of different levels. And here's what I'm asking you to do. Don't just reject them as those people. Pray, God, how can we partner with you to help them see their worth and value? And be not an accusing finger, but a hand that's showing them the better way. And in the story Jesus tells in Luke 15, he talks about a shepherd who loses a sheep. And then, I love it, he leaves the 99 and goes after until the sheep is found. Just get your mind around that concept, the pursuit of God. And then God's like a woman who lost a coin. And then when she found it, she rejoiced. And then God's like a father who loses a son. In the Jewish culture, for a son to say to a dad, I want my inheritance early, was such a statement of dishonor. In America here, we live in a kind of in the Eastern world, they live in an honor shame culture. We kind of live in a punishment judgment, a little bit more of a right wrong culture here in America. But in the honor shame culture, for you to dishonor your father was seen as dishonor was the most disrespectful thing you could do. So the younger son comes to his dad and says, I want my inheritance. Basically saying, I wish you were dead, wish you never existed, give me what's mine. And this radical father does something that would have been so radical to the Jewish listener. He gives him half of his inheritance. The scripture says that the young boy went and he squandered his wealth in wild living, prostitutes and partying. And he got to the end of the rope and all his friends were gone and all his money was gone. And he ended up, think about it, he ended up this Jewish boy working in a pig's pen. How ironic. Talk about not kosher. And while he's working in the pig's pen, he gets so hungry, he longs to even eat what the pigs are eating. And then he gets this thought. He comes to his senses and he says this, just maybe my father will have a little bit of mercy. And maybe I can just go back to my father and maybe I could just say, could you make me at least a hired servant? And he comes to himself and he starts down that road toward home. And the scripture says, and you can put it on the screen if you'd like, but the scripture says that his father saw him and the father ran and hugged him and kissed him. And as he was doing that, the boy says, Father, I have sinned against heaven and you, and I am no longer worthy to be your son. And you can almost hear the father just stopping his conversation. He says to his servant, quick, go get a coat. Go draw a bath. Go get a ring. Go get some new shoes. Kill the calf. Call a DJ. I mean, it was on here, he's saying. Because my son that was lost is now found, and he's gone, and he's back. And the son had a distorted view of the father because he thought he would just be a servant. But he repented. His thought changed. This is the core of what repentance means in the scripture, changing the way you think. I would propose repentance is the most positive word in scripture. He repented when he came to his senses in the pig pen, but also he repented when his dad said, oh no, you're not gonna be a slave, you're gonna be a son that's restored. And I don't know what it would have been like for the father to, in that culture, but it's interesting it says that he put a ring on his finger. Maybe when the son left, he took the family crest that was maybe on the ring and maybe he threw it in his dad's chest and says, no identity with you whatsoever. Maybe in the father's grief, as he got in the grief class at his local church because his son was having a tough time, which is a good place to go, and he was processing his pain, maybe that ring was a promise. Even though there's no finger on it now, it's still my son. And maybe there was a hope in that dad that said, someday when that boy comes back, he will not be a servant. He's my son. And if I could say to all of you in the room who have been hurt and trapped by shame because of your own sexual decisions that you've made that you regret like I have, or through the hurt caused by somebody else through abuse or through maybe an abortion or through rape or incest or something so horrific, male or female, that you feel unworthy because of that, That's a lie from the enemy, and that's called shame. And Jesus wants to come in, not to condemn us, but to heal us. And if I could today, I would put a ring on your finger and I would look you in the eyes, every single one of you who feel that shame. And if I could, I would wait here all day if I could, knowing it would help somebody. And I would proclaim to you with everything I have in me, you are the beloved of God. You are his son and his daughter, and you are worthy of love, and you are worthy of being restored. And this God isn't trying to punish or shame you. Sin has its own punishment. Trust me. This is a God that's trying to restore your soul. And when you find that healing of grace of God, and when you find that restoration, your soul begins to be free. And in recovery, we say you're as sick as your secrets. Well, I've already gone over my time. So how many will give me 2 more minutes? Raise your hand. Okay, 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12, 16, 18, 20. Okay. One last story. Dr. Henry Cloud says this. Dr. Henry Cloud says there's a difference between a legalistic church and a good AA group. He says in a legalistic church, it's culturally unacceptable to have problems. You're called a sinner. In a good AA group, he would say, it's culturally unacceptable to act like you ain't got any problems. That's called denial. He said, in a judgmental church, we attend and we look good, but we eventually get worse. He says, in a healthy AA group, we come in and we look worse, but we get better. And he says, I know they're good churches, and I believe that Northwoods is one of those good churches he's talking about, where it's okay to take your mask off and be real and honest, and there's groups and resources here to help you. But he says, I know there are good churches and bad AA groups, but because of a lack of grace and truth, and I would just even add, just a lack of being able to understand about our sexuality, many Christians have had to go out of church somewhere else to begin to find their healing. But I feel God's call on my life, and I want to ask anybody in the room that would join me to say, what if some of us tribal elders who've been through stuff? My daughter says, Dad, you don't look old. You just look like you've been through stuff. So tribal elders, you know what a tribal elder is? If you see the back of the head of the person in front of you and it's bald or gray, or you can see gray roots, come on, women, I know what this is all about. That's a tribal elder. I believe God's calling us tribal elders to share our story and help this younger generation of faith. I believe the younger generation won't start leaving the church. They'll actually come back to the church. You know why? Because we're becoming intimate like Father, Son, and Spirit. And we found God's grace and God's healing. And I know Northwoods has groups and pastors and resources, and the Pure Desire table is there. You can join an online group. Or maybe you're like me. Maybe you're going to find a therapist that can help you. But there are tools and resources that God has in this area of your life. And my prayer would be that whatever it takes, you would see that you're worth it. And you would listen to the Spirit's prompting. And we'll be here afterwards if you want to pray or talk to somebody. They'll be at our table where you can educate yourself to get these resources. But I got to tell you, Northwoods, it has been an honor for our team to be with you this week. And we pray that for somebody, this week has been an answer to their prayers. And that you would not just attend a service or buy hell insurance, but you would hear the call of God to participate in their relationship right here and now. The kingdom of God, eternal life, transformation. Let's pray. Father, thank you that you love us and you're for us and you have nothing but our best interest. You are safe and you desire to heal us. Give my friends courage to take that next step, to find people and resources that can help them. Thank you for loving us. And I know that you're trustworthy. The road may be difficult, but we're never alone. Your arms are always stretched out. We ask this all in the name of love, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen. Would you give it up for Rodney? Thank you, brother. Hey, I'm gonna ask you to stand with me for just a minute. I wanna talk for you just 1 second, but hey, say hi to Tracy as well over here. She can make her way out to the table. Rodney, maybe they're gonna be here prayer team will be down front. Rodney, I think, is going to stay here. Tracy probably as well. The team is out at the table, so go by. Thank them for being here. Check out the resources. But let me just say to you guys, we've had Pure Desire here before, and sometimes it's kind of like when they've left, the message is kind of, it's not that it's left, but we're going to elevate it. When you hear us say, hey, Conqueror Series, and we want you to be at the Conqueror Series. You've got kids and grandkids, and we need to help educate them. I want every dad, grandpa to come out for the Conqueror Series, right? You're going to be hearing those kinds of things. We've got seven pillars courses going. We're going to elevate this. I want us to be a church that's at the forefront of educating people about how to navigate our sexuality in a healthy way. Amen. Are you guys good with that? Let me pray for you. Father, I just bless our campus, all the other campuses, our online community. We thank you that you're a God who is always waiting to restore. And right now in Jesus' name, I just bind those lies of shame and fear that I can't come out of hiding. Lord, you're a God who wants to bring us out of hiding. You can't heal what we won't reveal, but you're a God who invites us to reveal so that the healing can start. And I pray you'd help us, Lord, to know how to be a gracious, safe, loving church that brings people into the truth and into the healing of God. I thank you, Lord, even as we walk this week, we are in your eyes without spot and blemish, and you're going to be there to help us, to keep us from falling. But Lord, help us to know as well that when we fall, you're there to pick us up. And we're a place where people can be okay to say, I'm not okay. God, we thank you for that. Would you bless our people this week? And we just give you all the thanks and praise for that in Jesus' mighty name. Everyone said, amen. Hey, God bless you guys. Have a great week. Join us next week as we finish up this series. But have an awesome week. Listen, go back again to the tables. Check it out. Thank Pure Desire for being here. And again, if you need prayer for anything, you come on down today, okay? God bless you. Those of you watching online, thank you for joining us in this. And listen, I pray if this spoke to you as well. How many of you know we were born broken, right? And part of that is broken in our sexuality. If you need help, don't isolate, okay? Reach out. We have resources. We have groups. We'd love to have you be a part of that. God bless you. Have a great week. And we'll see you back next week. Change on the choice, but to break.